We're not here to follow a sales script. We're here to help you. It's all part of the service.
So what I'm talking is not about sustainability. I'm not talking about bottom line. I'm not talking about green. I'm talking just about how to reinvent everything to make it good instead of less bad. And this is about tolerance. It's about rationality, progress, maturity. It's about human rights. And in a very interesting way, I work mostly in the United States. Our president, George Bush, it's very beneficial for our country because he clearly says, I don't do anything. So now everybody knows it's up to me. Yeah. So therefore, I want to talk how to reinvent things. First, we start, because I'm a chemist, a scientist, first I need to design it, to find out where I am. So I analyze what is going on. What you see is a gas chromatogram, where you see every signal here is at least one chemical. And this is a Mattel toy, yeah, the world's largest maker of children's toys. And we find up to 30 carcinogens in these toys off-gassing or being able to be taken up. So these toys are made in China for $1, and they're sold in Europe for $30. And they're never made for children. So in 2003, Willie McDonough and I got the Presidential Award on Green Chemistry. And I used the opportunity to say, look, dear Mr. President, you don't need to go to Iraq to find chemical weapons. Yeah? Here they are. Yeah? To be clear, it's not about plastic being bad. Yeah? Look at Lego, look at Playmobil, and we don't work with any of these companies. Just they make clean plastics. Yeah? They don't stink. They don't off-gas. So it's not about that it's necessary to do so when it's plastic, not at all. So it doesn't make sense to make things free of. You need to define what you have, positively, every ingredient. It's like when I invite you for dinner, it doesn't help if I say, oh, it's free of chicken. Yeah, I tell you what it is. So this is why the campaign, what Icebreaker, for example, does, and Jeremy Moon told me that there are a lot of people like Icebreaker mentalities thinking to do the same, traceability of materials. But in Europe, it's different. In Europe, we are doing a phase of ecologism. So we do as if, but we don't really do anything. So we keep the people quiet, like the music on the Titanic somehow, yeah? So we keep the people quiet and we do as if. Like, for example, Europe is banning asbestos from brake pads, yeah? So everybody thinks, oh, Volkswagen says, oh, brake pads are free of asbestos. But nobody asks what is in there. Yeah? So instead, there is antimony sulfate in it, which is a much stronger carcinogen. So what does it help you to make things free of? Yeah? You really need to define what you have. We make buildings which are not healthy. If you look at the indoor air quality of buildings in Europe and here as well in this country, I looked at some studies, the indoor air quality in a building here, the average indoor air quality is about 3 to 8 times worse than the worst air in Auckland. These buildings are never made for indoor. So what we do is traditionally we take materials, we make stuff, and we put it into landfills. We talk about cradle to grave. So with this, we are at the end, the whole planet will be a big graveyard, and we will lose all the materials for that. And for that, we have far too many people on this planet. So when people think they protect the environment when they destroy a little less. The government of New Zealand, but as well the European government, does the same. They said, please protect the environment, don't use your car that often. But that would be the same if I would say, please protect your child, don't beat your child that often. So we are not protecting when we destroy just a little less. Yeah? We only destroy a little less. And therefore, we are too many people on this planet. So somehow we generated this feeling that we are too many people on this planet and it would be better if we wouldn't exist. So this is why we have all these types of things like zero waste, zero emission, reduction of our footprint, you know, all the guilt management. We are guilty anyways and we try to be less bad. Yeah, there are 5 million children dying every year because they don't have healthy drinking water. And we let them die because we are too many. But are we really too many? Look at ants on this planet, these little insects. And then you see, the ants work much harder than we do. They live much shorter than we do. And are they an environmental problem? Yes, when I have them in my apartment, sure. But otherwise, rainforest wouldn't exist without ants. No way. There would be no rainforest because when there would be no ants, they would not process the nutrients back. So are they too many? The weight of ants, when you take all the ants here and all the human beings there, the weight is about 3 to 4 to 5 times, depending on the scientific work, bigger than of human beings. And because they live so much shorter and they work so much physically harder than we do, they equal about 30 billion people in their calorie consumption. So are we too many? No, we are too stupid. Our design is not good. Yeah? If our material flow design would be like ants, we could be far more people on this planet. So we don't need to apologize every morning that we are on this planet. We can apologize for being so stupid. But when we do apologize, we can start to do things. Not only in Germany, we learn that human beings forget about ethics immediately when they're in a crisis. So when you make it an ethical problem in your company, then you will not solve it when you need it, because then you don't have ethics. Think about you in a traffic jam, for example. Think about you in a supermarket when you have to shop very fast. So when you make it an ethical problem, then it doesn't help, because it's very much simpler. Who is now no longer taking care of the greenhouse effect is just an idiot. If you don't want to be stupid, you take care of the greenhouse effect now. So it's a quality thing. It's not ethics, it's not sustainability, it's just quality. Yeah? It's just quality of science. What you do is we do eco-efficiency. Yeah? We say, oh yes, we are bad, and we try to be less bad. And on the Titanic, we are not just rearranging the deck chairs, that's not true. We are somehow replacing the teaspoon with a tablespoon to bail out the border, because it goes in the right direction, yeah, sure. But to be clear, eco-efficiency will not help us, not at all. It's even the opposite. What we could see in Germany, that East Germany was protecting the environment so much better than West Germany, just by inefficiency. So when you do something wrong, don't make it efficient, because then it's perfectly wrong. Yeah. So East Germany, just by being inefficient, the communist system being completely inefficient, they left a lot of local contamination behind, but overall the species diversity in East Germany was so much higher than in West Germany, and the soil quality as well. You know why? Because the system was not efficient. They couldn't destroy all the wetlands. So the best environmental protection is by inefficiency, if we stay in the efficiency game. And to be clear, efficiency is ugly. Yeah. Think about falling in love with somebody efficiently. Think about Mozart being efficient, Van Gogh being efficient. Everything in life, what is nice, is not efficient. This is a traditional thing. We assume we are bad anyways. We are 100% bad, and we try to minimize being bad, and the goal is to be zero. Yeah. All this guilt management, reduction, avoidance, minimization, prevention. And this is not an attractive business curve, isn't it? So when you do any type of eco-label, this will be the future of your business, because everybody will ask yourself, for example, for a carpet, whatever, we'd say, hey, do I really need a new carpet? Couldn't I wait another year? Do I really need this chair? Yeah. Yeah. So it drives yourself out of business, because by not buying the stuff, you could even protect the environment better. Yeah. So this is not good. Don't do any type of these green labels, because you reach the opposite. You drive yourself out of business. Efficiency means doing things right. Yeah? Effectiveness means doing the right thing. Yeah? So what is the right thing to do? And then you choose what you need to do. Now you have a positive agenda. It's no longer about reducing, avoiding, minimizing. It's about optimizing, supporting, increasing, defining. So now you don't need to be perfect anymore. Yeah? You don't need to say, oh, I'm 100% whatever. No, you can say, hey, I have 20% of what I want to do. And the more, dear customer, the more you buy, the quicker we are. So buying is a good thing. So it's no longer about a triple bottom line, yeah, what you see in the program. It's a triple top line. You make things which are good for the environment, good for society, and good for the business at the same time. Yeah? So we are beneficial instead of less bad. Now you have a positive business curve. Look at the tree. Yeah. No reduction, no avoidance, no minimization, no guilt management. 200 species. Yeah. Look at a building like a tree. Yeah. A building which could make oxygen, a building which makes soil, which takes care of the water, which generates life for hundreds of other species. No reduction, no avoidance, no minimization, no guilt. Yeah. It's celebrating abundance. We talk about waste equals food because there is no waste. Like in the ants metabolism, there is no waste. It's only nutrients. But even this is misleading, as we learned. Yeah. So this is why my slogan is this. Yeah. So we don't need to reduce, to avoid, to minimize. We need to learn how to use our materials. So we can define what we have positively. A is ideal, B is principally okay, C it can be tolerated, and X needs to be phased out for all ingredients. And then we have a positive curve. And we don't need to be perfect. Our customer is our friend, because our customer, the more the customer buys from Interface, for example, the faster the company can change. Yeah. So you can be beneficial with what you do. Everything is a nutrient. Everything needs to go into a biological cycle or a technical cycle. Because we don't consume a carpet, we don't consume a washing machine, we don't consume a TV set. Look, when you take it out of the TV set now, when you take out the LED, what does it help you? We analyze the TV set and we find in the TV set 4,360 different chemicals. So what does it help when you now have 4,359? But you don't consume your TV set. Even if your favorite rugby team doesn't win, you don't eat your TV set, or do you? Yeah. Yeah. So you only use it, you only have a service of it. There we distinguish between technical nutrition and biological nutrition. The ants only stay in the technical cycle, but look, we don't want to live just like ants. This would be sustainable. Yeah? The same thing over and over again. And somebody else tells you always what you have to do. Yeah? No, we want to watch TV. We want to have washing machines. Yeah? Therefore, we need technical nutrient cycles as well. So we need to make stuff which goes in the technosphere or the biosphere. And I want to give you examples for that. Now you have a positive agenda. The first one, which we did, is an edible fabric. Because when you sit on your chair and somebody makes this chair, the pieces you cut off are so toxic that they need to go into hazardous waste incinerators in Europe. Ecologism. It doesn't help the environment, but people do as if. Yeah. It's like socialism was never social. Yeah. Ecologism will not help the ecology. So what we did is we choose all ingredients in these fabrics because they get consumed, that you could even eat them. And therefore, these fabrics now are used, for example, as a new Airbus, because indoor air quality in an airplane is crucial. And they're about 20% cheaper. So it's not about, oh, we need to pay more for it. No, because now the pieces you cut off need to be are designed to go back in the biosphere. People talk about stopping greenhouse gas emission and carbon dioxide. But this is somehow strange. They forget completely that two-thirds of all the carbon is in soil. United States lost in the last 200 years half of the whole topsoil of the nation. Yeah. Europe is losing in 1 year the topsoil which has been built in 5,000 years. Yeah. So we need to rebuild soil, yeah, under all circumstances. Compared to that, it's completely irrelevant how much we are emitting as carbon dioxide compared to what we lose when we lose topsoil. Yeah. You can do a lot of things, like we do. It chose the chemicals for the mirror chair from Herman Miller. Maybe you know the chair. It's the most successful chair from Herman Miller ever in company's history. And it's profitable. Just between us, it's a business conference. The profit rate of this chair is more than 40%. Yeah. So what we do is we make a chair which is designed for this assembly. So the assembly process is so much easier with that. Yeah. We will have the first TV set, a real pay-per-view TV set, where you just pay for watching TV, no longer for the TV. Then you can use the best stuff, not the cheapest, because you just sell the service of using that. The whole Netherlands are turning into a cradle-to-cradle country. All the procurement will be cradle-to-cradle. $60 billion of purchasing power will go into cradle-to-cradle. And they work now on the criteria for all the different things, on buildings, on transportation, on clothing, to make everything nutrient. This is why I'm so glad that you're here. Yeah. The middle management needs to be efficient, but the top management needs to be effective. Yeah. needs to say, what is the right thing? Like you did it, Ray, for years, to say, where do we want to be? In 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years, what is the long-term perspective? And that's effectiveness. It's no longer about sustainability. It's we use 30 years of blaming and shaming for innovation. So I'm only talking about using this for innovation, nothing else. This is United Nations work. It defines a human development index, which is on the top. The X is on the top. So India, for example, has a human development index of 0.6. And Saudi Arabia has a human development index of 0.95. You can see United States here takes 9.5 planets, basically, with the lifestyle which they have. If there's only one country which meets this goal of a high human development index and a low footprint. The only country which meets this criteria is Cuba. I want to have a big footprint, but a beneficial one. Ants have a large, huge footprint, but everything what they do is beneficial. So don't apologize for being on this planet, but be better by design. Cradle to cradle is you find in different countries. Different versions, different languages. There are two Chinese versions of it, in the old Chinese and the new China. But to be clear, the Chinese will not get it, because it first needs a free society. It needs your spirit for that. It needs your entrepreneurship, because out of fear, people cannot be creative. When people have fear that you question their existence, then they are not creative, and they are not really able to do innovation. And first of all, it needs a free society for blaming and shaming for 30 years, basically. You need to learn about this. Eco-efficiency was useful. It was essential to understand toxicity. It was essential to understand about environmental problems. But now the time is over for that, not only my speech. Sustainability is just the minimum, and it's not enough. So thank you for listening to me, and I wish you a nice conference. Thank you.